Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, our weekly Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exhort, we edify, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about the friendly foe. It's an oxymoron, right? The friendly foe. And our case study is going to be our first parents, Adam and Eve. But before we go into our lesson, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Because you are not just our God, you are also our Father. And you're a good Father. The Father that wants the best for his children. And so we have come to you in this lesson. Feed us from your table of life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Adam and Eve. And our foundation text is taken from the book of Proverbs, chapter 20, verse 17. That's a very popular verse with the chapter and the verse. Proverbs 20:17. And I will read. It says, bread gained by deceit is sweet to a man, but afterward his mouth will be filled with gravel. That is not talking literally about the gravel that you use to fill up your foundation. This is a proverb, and it is mostly using a metaphor. So it's just talking about at the end of doing something evil secretly, the result is not going to be nice. So here you need three proofs to identify the friendly foe. Because like we said in the topic, the foe, the enemy we're talking about is very friendly. So you're not gonna see this enemy as an enemy. No, it's going to present itself to you as your friend, as my friend. So how do I know the friendly foe? How do you know the friendly foe? You need three proofs. When you have those three strikes, then you know you are dealing with the enemy. The proof number one, it lures with pleasure. Because the objective of this enemy is not to strike once and leave, but to enslave. That is why pleasure is an integral part of its deception. Listen up. Eve repeated her foolishness because she found eating the fruit enjoyable. You see, if the fruit was bitter, Eve wouldn't have continued in that madness, you see. So she not only ate the fruit, she also extended it to her husband, Adam, you see. Anything, listen up, anything that only presents the goodies but fails to present possible consequences is a friendly foe wrapped in the silky, soothing pack of lies. All right? Why? Because God, by principle, has created life with the balance of pros and cons, you see. Anything contrary to that is a fraud, a fool. Even salvation, the best thing that can ever happen to anybody is to give your life to Jesus. Even when you become a child of God and you start following the Bible in your daily life, guess what? It has its own consequences too. Because you will be ostracized by those who don't believe in what you believe, you see. So there's nothing in life that does not have pros and cons. But when the enemy comes and is presenting you in a friendly way, oh, this is all good, you have nothing to worry about, it's time to take a walk. That is the friendly fool, all right? Proverbs chapter 1 verse 10, my son, if sinners entice you, do not consent. The pleasure in sin is the evil in sin. Let's say that bread on the go again. The pleasure in sin is the evil in sin. Moving on. Your friendly foe secures with treasure. The promise of becoming like God became the treasure which Eve was after, as well as her husband, you see. These promises made to them by Satan became the treasure they were looking forward to as their gain from their disobedient act. And so they found an excuse, or so they thought, to disobey God. Anytime you have to reason out your action to justify, well, it may not feel right, it may not settle well with me, but anytime you have to go through that, you are being deceived. Unfortunately, this is the same bait with which Adam and Eve's friendly foe fastened them to his trap, you see. The treasure that he was showing them, that you will be like God, is the same thing that he wanted to use and did use to trap them. An adulterer see their adulterous partner as the treasure of their atrocious behavior, you see. This is why many go ahead to break their marriage vows, which was a covenant relationship recognized by God. To move into an adulterous relationship which God hates, and such a relationship is cursed by God. Even two people who are unbelievers, the moment they come together openly to come and get married as a man and a woman, all right? It is a covenant. Whatever gain or treasure from an action that does not line up with the word of God is a friendly foe in disguise, you see. So it doesn't matter what you are going to gain from a decision or from a treasure, if it doesn't line up with the word of God, it's not a treasure, it's not a gain, it's a trap. A brother was sharing with one of us a few years back about his church, and he said in his church that they will once they put anointing oil on you to anoint you for a position in the church, that is the same thing as putting handcuffs on your hands, because they will use that to bribe you into silence, you see. That is not a game, that is a trap, you see. Let's go into the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 6, verse 9. 1 Timothy, chapter 6, verse 9. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. You see, the gain or the riches that the Bible is talking about here is not only about money. You see, maybe a favor at work, if it's going to involve you to do something that is contrary, that is not extending favor to you. You are being trapped. Don't fall for it. It's the enemy wanting to secure you with a treasure. The enemy comes to bait and slay. The enemy comes to bait and slay. Moving on. Your friendly foe touches with pressure. Adam and his wife knew the shame of nakedness for the first time. They had the knowledge of right and wrong for the first time. And they experienced fear for the first time. All these negatives culminated together and put pressure on them and made them to run and hide, you see. Listen up. It doesn't matter if you're a Buddhist, Islamist, or whatever they go by. Satan has no good plan for anyone. Let me repeat that. Satan has no good plan for anyone. Atheist, it doesn't matter who you are. Satan has no good plan for you. The devil does not love you. Oh no. And the devil is incapable of showing mercy to you or to me. So let's get that straight. Because this devil's very nature is evil. You can't spell evil without devil, you see. So his very nature is evil. After Satan has used sin to get an individual to his cage, or in your case, if you're an atheist, the devil is using your not wanting to believe there is God, he's using that to deceive you. After it has used that to put you in his cage, the devil begins to exert pressure on your life and present you with situations that look hopeless and without any exit. However, God always creates an exit if you ask. You need to ask. Let's go to the book of Proverbs, chapter 12, verse 10. Proverbs 12, 10. A righteous man regards the life of his animal, but the tender mercies of the wicked are cruel. You see, the devil is a wicked being, very wicked. He knows his case is hopeless, beyond redemption. So he has no mercy for you. He has no mercy for me. So stop doing the devil's work. Stop believing the lies of the devil and come to Jesus, because it's only in Jesus that you can find mercy, that you can find favor and goodness. Amen. Satan's cookie always comes with Satan's fury. Joseph in Zion said that again. Satan's cookie always comes with Satan's fury. Don't take the devil's cookies. Now, we have talked about the three ways or the three proofs that you need to establish when a friendly foe is around you or trying to deceive you. Now let's talk about how you can stop the work of the friendly foe in your life, in case you are looking at the old thing and you're saying, Josephine Zion, I think I'm done for already. I think the devil already got me. Despair not. Listen, you can still come out of the enemy's cage. Now, let's see how that can be possible. Number one, confess. This is a vertical transaction between you and God. Confession is to vocalize our agreement with God's perspective of right and wrong, you see. It is to state the exact wrong we have committed and ask for God's forgiveness. Don't just say, God, forgive me. Oh, no. God, I lie a lot. I lied about this. I lied about that. Please forgive me. Oh, God, I steal. I shoplifted from this business, from that business. Forgive me. You have to state the exact thing you have done wrong. All right? And then you ask God to forgive you. The devil, listen up, discourages people from confessing because of the perceived repercussions that will befall them. However, listen up close, please. This is a lie. The devil is a liar. Because the devil knows that to confess is to invite God's intervention into the situation. And this puts immediate stoppage to Satan's evil work in your life. It stops the devil's work immediately you confess. You see, 1 John chapter 1 verse 9, you can take this anytime, any day and say, God, even though I could have murdered somebody, even though I could have done this bad, whatever you have done, say it. But you said in your word, 1 John chapter 1 verse 9, a very popular verse, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You can take that to God at any time and ask for forgiveness. And on the authority of his word, you can be sure that he will forgive you because he has promised. Confession is to save you. Confession is not to shame you. We used this very bread on the go about a year ago when we first started this program. And the Holy Spirit said, you need to say that again to these people so that people who have been deceived by the devil will know it's a lie. Confession is to save you. So don't think if you confess, it's going to put you into shame. That's the devil's lie. Confession is not to shame you. Moving on. You not only confess, you repent. This is an internal transaction with yourself. All right? When you confess, you're transacting with God. When you are repenting, you are transacting with yourself. All right? This is to change course from the previous evil path and turn a new leaf in every possible way. This may include changing your environment, your circle of friends, or your job. This is a bold declaration to those around you that you intend to follow through with your new way of life. You see, when I became a child of God, I tried as much as possible to reach out to my old friends to let them know, hey, listen, I'm a Jesus girl now. Unfortunately, not a whole lot of them were enthusiastic about my new faith, you see. Today, we don't talk anymore. I don't hate them personally. But we are not just together in the same boat anymore, you see. It is also a proactive way to avoid a repeat performance of the evil of the past. This very repentance section reminded me of a lovely, lovely sister. That was about 3 or 4 years back when we went to Sealy for one of our outreaches. And she listened to the message and she became a child of God. And she started calling the ministry during the week after that outreach. And she would say, I need y'all to pray for me because the devil is trying me. And we would pray for her. And she would say some people are making her angry and all that. Then I couldn't get hold of her for like 1 or 2 weeks after that. I tried calling her phone because we do follow up with our new converts. I couldn't get hold of her. Well, cut a long story short, eventually she got back to me. And I said, Sister ABC, I've been trying to reach you. Where have you been? Oh, I moved. I'm cutting everybody off. And we just laughed in the ministry because the way she said it, you would know she was really mad at the devil. You see, she said, I had to leave that place. friendship, she moved to the next town. She said, I need to cut everybody off. I need a new life. She was repenting because she knew if she stayed in that same town where she got saved, she would go back to her old way of life. So she literally packed up and moved to the next town. You see, that is being wise. The book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 28. Ephesians 4, 28. Let him who stole steal no longer. You see, that is changing course. But rather, let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need, you see. So you not only confess, you also have a part to play. You have to repent, change your course from bad to good. Now let's go to the third one, redress. And I'm going to be very careful here in redressing a situation. This is a horizontal transaction with a person who could have been hurt by our actions. So you confess, which is vertical between you and God, then you repent, which is an internal transaction with yourself. Now you want to redress, which is horizontal transaction concerning a fellow person or human being that you have hurt with your bad deeds. This is to go to the other person and ask for their forgiveness. Now listen up close, please. Depending on the degree of the hurt, godly wisdom is needed. All right? Spiritual mentors or counselors will be of help in a case where the sin caused a great deal of harm to the person offended. And this may be something like family issues, infidelities in marriage, you know, and all kinds of family stuff. In a case where the past wrongdoing is a heavy one, don't just go and blob it to the person. No. Pray, fast. I had to do that when I became a child of God, and God began to release godly wisdom for me to be able to redress that situation and God to the glory, you see. So pray, fast, involve maybe your pastor, your spiritual mentors, or Christian counselors. Now, where it is practically impossible to ask for forgiveness, for example, the person you offended is now dead. There's nothing you can do about that. Or they moved locations, like somebody who did something against me, say 20, 21, 22 years ago. If they are looking for me, unless they watch this program, they're not gonna know where I live now. Why? Because in the last 20 years, I've lived in 4 countries on 3 continents, you see. So in case that person has moved and you don't know where they are, here is what you do. You write out what you want to, what you will have said to that person. Write it down on a paper and get a chair and read it out to that person, okay? In faith, and believe it is settled, okay? Believe it is settled because God has forgiven you. So really, it is settled, okay? Let's read the book of Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14. And I took my time on that section because a lot of people, they just do it with zeal without any wisdom, and it causes so much harm. Hebrews 12, 14, it says, pursue peace with all people and holiness. Part of holiness is to redress a situation with a fellow human being that you could have hurt. Not only with God, you do it with God, and then you also ask for the forgiveness of the people you have hurt, and you forgive yourself too. Without which no one will see the Lord. It doesn't matter how nice and wonderful you are, if there's no holiness in your life, forget it. The Bible says you're not gonna see the Lord. A clean conscience is a strong conscience. A clean conscience is a strong conscience. Now, what have we done so far? What are the proofs to identify your friendly foe, my friendly foe? Number one, it lures with pleasure. Sin is always, always wrapped in pleasure to make it attractive. It secures with treasure. Sin always has a little gift, all right? Gift, in quotes. To give whoever it deceives, but really it's not a gift, it's a bait. It tortures with pressure. Satan moves in to molest after sin has done its job. How can you stop the work of the friendly foe in your life? How can I stop the work of the friendly foe in my life? Number one, confess. We have to confess. Tell God what you have done and ask for his forgiveness. Number two, we have to repent. Make practical changes to avoid the repeat of the same previous error. Number three, we have to redress. Ask for the forgiveness of those you offended if it's safe to do so. Now let's conclude. Sin is the forebear or forerunner of Satan. And sin is the closest enemy to human beings, you see. Because it's in the crooked DNA passed down to us from Adam, you see. So sin is our closest enemy. It's the one that the devil uses to open the front door of our lives to Satan, you see. Are you being lured as a Christian to violate your spiritual values? Huh? Are you? Your boss at work is pressuring you to have an affair, and now you are scared you may lose your job or he will vilify you. Huh? Listen. Refuse to bow to evil. That is evil. The devil is trying to use that boss to open the door into your life to come and destroy you. Whatever the enemy is trying to lure you with, the devil is trying to use that to open the front door of your life to come in to destroy you. Don't refuse to be violated. Refuse it. Be ready to pay the price. Because God is going to honor you. If you refuse to bow to evil, God will honor you. You may have to go through some rough time of having to look for another job or losing a friend or friendship. Guess what? God will honor you. Your soul is that important. Walk away from evil. Walk away from that sin that is luring and enticing you in Jesus' name. Now, you are saying, Josephine Zion, my problem is not like somebody is trying to lure me. I don't even have this Jesus in my life. And I've done so many bad things. My sins are too big. And I've gone too far. Is that what you're saying, huh? Listen up. Examples abound of people in the Bible and in real life, natural life, about people, and I am among one of those people who have received the mercy of God when we ask for forgiveness. Every Christian you see have had to ask for God's mercy for forgiveness before they became a child of God. So don't think you are far too gone to be redeemed. Satan and demons are the only ones who have gone too far to be redeemed. But if you are a human being and you can still hear me, and you are not rebellious, you want to change, you want to give your life to Jesus, listen, there's still room for you at the cross of Jesus Christ. Your sin is not too big for the blood of Jesus to wash clean. Oh no. Mm-mm. If you are ready to receive this free gift of forgiveness from Jesus Christ, a link is coming up very shortly. Click on that link and it will take you to where you can have this transaction between you and God vertically. And we will give you instructions on what to do. And on the authority of the Word of God, if you call out to Jesus to forgive you your sins, He will, because He has promised. All right? Let us pray. Father, thank you for exposing the enemy in us, the friendly enemy that works with the devil to want to destroy us. Father, we pray that for all of your children, among whom I'm one, Father, I pray that you will strengthen us, O Lord, in the inner man by your Spirit in the name of Jesus. That we will not give in to sin. We will not give in to its pleasure. We will not give in to its treasure. And we will not give in to sin's pressure in the name of Jesus. And for any of your children who have already given in, we ask, O Lord, that you will give them the grace to rise up like the prodigal son and come back to you to ask for forgiveness. And as many who are going to want to know Jesus page, to go and have that transaction with you, for their sins to be cleaned and be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Father, I pray that you will open their eyes and let them understand the transaction they are about to enter into with you, and give them the assurance that indeed you have forgiven them. Thank you, Father, Lord, for in Jesus' name I will pray. Amen and amen. I will see you next week if Jesus has not split the sky open.